Gildan Audio presents an unabridged recording of Bargaining for Advantage, Negotiation Strategies for Reasonable People, Second Edition, by G. Richard Schell, narrated by Sean Pratt. For Robbie, Ben, and Ned, who have taught me so much. Preface to the Second Edition. It's with real pleasure that I offer this second edition of Bargaining for Advantage. I wrote this book in the late 1990s because I was dissatisfied with the existing set of works for serious students and practitioners of this fascinating process we call negotiation. I wanted a book that would explore the immense variety of real-world negotiations, provide both historical context and a social science foundation for deal-making, and be fun to read. The appearance of this new edition and the many foreign translations of this work, more than 10 at last count, suggest the book hit its mark. So, why improve on something that works? 4 reasons. First and foremost, a new edition gives me a chance to share with readers a new bargaining styles assessment tool, which can be found in Appendix A. I believe that many negotiators have distinctive talents, strengths, and weaknesses rooted in personality. These traits are not set in concrete, but they generate biases and preferences that strongly affect how they behave at the bargaining table. I designed this bargaining styles assessment instrument to probe such negotiation instincts. By including my new test here, along with a standardized grid for evaluating your results in comparison with those of more than 1,500 executives from all over the world, I hope listeners can come away from the book with a deeper understanding of the kind of negotiator they are when they are at their best. The second reason for a new edition has to do with advancing communication technology. At the time I was writing Bargaining for Advantage, the world had not yet become as dependent as it is now on internet-enabled electronic communication systems, such as email and instant messaging. This second edition gives me a chance to directly address the perils and promise of electronic negotiations, which I do in Chapter 7. This same chapter also features a new section on using agents in the bargaining process, an important topic I neglected earlier. Third, I have become more aware since publishing the first edition of the importance of gender and culture as negotiation variables. I therefore address these topics in Chapter 1 in more detail than before. The publication in 2003 of Linda Babcock's and Sarah Lashever's Women Don't Ask, Negotiation and the Gender Divide helped clarify the gender issue in a particularly helpful way. Finally, this edition gives me a chance to edit and supplement a variety of stories, research studies, and topics that will keep the work fresh. Throughout, however, my intention has been to leave what has worked well largely intact. With that said, I present this new edition. I sincerely hope it guides you on one of the most interesting and potentially profitable journeys that life has to offer, the journey toward effectiveness in all of your negotiations. G. Richard Schell. Introduction. It's your move. At the Wharton School, I teach negotiation to some of the best and brightest business people in the world, both students and executives. I also serve as the academic director for a week-long negotiation program for senior managers called the Wharton Executive Negotiation Workshop, Bargaining for Advantage. But despite these credentials, I have to admit that bargaining can make me a little anxious. In fact, sometimes I don't even realize I'm negotiating at all until it's too late. For example, not long ago, I was sitting at the dinner table with my family when the telephone rang. I answered. It was my neighbor's teenage daughter, Emily. "I'm raising money for our school softball team so we can take a trip this winter to play in a tournament," she explained. "We're selling citrus fruits like oranges and grapefruits. Would you like to buy some?" We're friends with Emily's family and have known her since she was 4. Naturally, I wanted to help out. "Tell me about it," I said. She explained the various packages and prices. $11 for the small sampler, $20 for a package with more grapefruit, $35 for the grand collection. I found myself wondering where we were going to store $35 worth of citrus fruit. Okay, I said at the end of the pitch. I'll take the $11 package. Just then, my wife, Robbie, got my attention. Ask Emily about the guinea pig, she said. I looked puzzled. My older son, Ben, joined in a little more loudly. Ned's guinea pig, he explained. See if she can take care of Ned's guinea pig this weekend while we're away. Our 8-year-old had recently acquired a pet guinea pig that needed a sitter for the fast-approaching Thanksgiving weekend. Ah, I said. I got back onto the phone. Are you going to be here this weekend? I asked. Yes, came the reply. Could you take care of Ned's guinea pig for us? We'll be in New York and we need to find her a home. No problem, she replied brightly. And then she went on without missing a beat. In that case, do you think you could buy the $25 package? It was my move. Sure, I said with a laugh. We'll take the $25 package. Negotiations, from the mega mergers on Wall Street to budget meetings at work to everyday encounters at home, take unexpected turns and involve high stakes so often that many graduate professional schools in the United States now offer semester-long courses on the subject. In fact, they are some of the most sought-after courses in the entire curriculum. Why? Because students entering professional life, whether in business, law, medicine, education, politics, or public administration, are anxious about negotiation and want to improve their skills. They know they will face all sorts of negotiation challenges in their future roles as business and professional leaders, and they want to replace their anxiety with greater confidence. These students are acting wisely because anxiety hampers negotiation performance in predictable ways. It interferes with our ability to think on our feet and narrows our perspective about the problem we are solving. More critically, anxiety leads many reasonable people to seek simplistic answers to the question, how should I negotiate? They grasp at phrases like win-win and win-lose, hoping these formulas will explain what negotiation is about. Anxious negotiators search for a single, one-size-fits-all strategy that will give them a feeling of control over the process. But these attempts to simplify negotiations just don't work. First, all deals that close are win-win deals. The two sides would not agree to a proposal unless they thought agreement was better for them than no deal. Second, win-lose is often just a label we give a deal when we don't like the way the other side treated us. Finally, all-purpose strategies are an illusion. Experienced negotiators know that there are too many situational and personal variables for a single strategy to work in all cases. To become more effective, you need to get beyond simple negotiation ideas such as these. You need to confront your anxieties, accept the fact that no two negotiators and situations are the same, and learn to adapt to these differences realistically and intelligently, while maintaining your ethics and self-respect. And to achieve these goals, you need something more than simple phrases. You need a confident attitude based on testing and reliable knowledge about the negotiation process. Such knowledge is at hand. The last 25 years has seen a veritable explosion of negotiation research and writing, but it is relatively inaccessible. Negotiation scholars publish their findings on negotiation in academic journals and books that most real-world negotiators don't read. And it's hard for reasonable people to sift the good advice from the bad in the popular writing on bargaining. Just because a technique works well for a sports celebrity or Hollywood agent does not mean it will work for you. Look inside your toolbox. It's your move. This is why I wrote Bargaining for Advantage. In my work at the Wharton School, I have canvassed both the academic and popular literatures on bargaining in search of ideas and approaches that dependably help people achieve superior results at the bargaining table. And I have organized this knowledge in a straightforward way so busy people can use it. My approach to negotiation starts with you. My own experience and a lot of research tell me that you already have what it takes to be a competent negotiator. You have a set of tools in your own personal negotiation toolbox. The same basic communication and cognitive skills that got you where you are today, advancing toward your personal and professional goals, are the ones needed to negotiate effectively. And everyone, regardless of their current skill level, can improve their performance by identifying their strengths and weaknesses, planning more carefully, and sharpening their tools through practice. Many people are naturally accommodating and cooperative. Others are basically competitive. Some are equally effective using either approach, but there is only one truth about a successful bargaining style. To be good, you must learn to be yourself at the bargaining table. Tricks and stratagems that don't feel comfortable won't work. Besides, while you're worrying about your next tactic, the other party is giving away vital clues and information that you're missing. To negotiate well, you do not need to be tricky, but it helps to be alert and prudent. The best negotiators play it straight, ask a lot of questions, listen carefully, and concentrate on what they and the other party are trying to accomplish at the bargaining table. Negotiation is not rocket science, but it is not simple intuition either. No matter who you are, your intuition will fail you in important bargaining situations. To improve, you need to shed your assumptions about the process and open yourself to new ideas. Most of all, you must learn to recognize the hidden psychological strategies that play such important roles in the process. For example, as this book will show you, skilled negotiators see more than just opening offers, counteroffers, and closing moves when they look at what happens at the bargaining table. They see psychological and strategic currents that are running just below the surface. They notice where the parties stand in terms of the reciprocity norm. They look for opportunities to use what psychologists call the consistency principle to commit other parties to standards and then hold them to their prior statements or positions, and they know that the timing of a proposal is almost as important as its content. People need to feel they have earned concessions even when you are willing to give them away for free. Knowledge of these and other patterns embedded in the negotiation process help experienced negotiators structure their proposals and predict what the other party will do next. Once you learn to see these and similar features of the bargaining landscape, you too will be able to read bargaining situations more accurately and make your moves with more confidence. The approach: information-based bargaining. I call my approach to negotiation information-based bargaining. This approach focuses on three main aspects of negotiation: solid planning and preparation before you start, careful listening so you can find out what the other side really wants, and attending to the signals the other party sends through his or her conduct once bargaining gets underway. As the name suggests, information-based bargaining involves getting as much reliable knowledge about the situation and other party as possible. My approach focuses on six factors, or as I call them, foundations of effective negotiation. These six foundations, which make up part one of the book, are your personal bargaining styles, your goals and expectations, authoritative standards and norms, relationships, the other party's interests, and the diverse ingredients that go into that most important of all bargaining assets, leverage. This idea is explained in detail in Chapter 6. With information on these foundations in hand, you are ready to move down the predictable path that negotiations follow. From the creation of a bargaining plan, to preliminary exchanges of information, to explicit back-and-forth bargaining, and finally to the closing and commitment stage. Part 2 of the book will walk you through this four-stage process step by step. Information-based bargaining is a skeptical school of negotiation. It treats each situation and person you face as unique. It cautions against making overtly confident assumptions about what others want or what might be motivating them. And it emphasizes situational strategies, tailored to the facts of each case, rather than a single one-size-fits-all formula. To help you learn, the book illustrates the principles of information-based bargaining with stories from the lives of some of the best negotiators who ever lived. You will study bargaining strategies used by successful people from many cultures and eras, including Sony Corporation's legendary founder, Akio Morita, American tycoons such as J.P. Morgan, John D. Rockefeller Sr., and Andrew Carnegie, modern dealmakers, H. Wayne Huizinga, and Donald Trump, historical figures such as Mahatma Gandhi and Benjamin Franklin, and a variety of less well-known but equally talented business people and community leaders. You will see how these experts succeeded and, just as important, learn how they sometimes failed. Such role models can teach us a lot, but even more important than their experiences are their attitudes about negotiation. The best negotiators treat bargaining seriously, but they also keep a professional perspective. They can always walk away. They maintain their balance no matter what the other side does, respond promptly to the other party's maneuvers, and keep moving patiently and persistently toward their goals. The best negotiators also have explicit ethical guidelines for their own conduct at the table, regardless of what others may do. They know which moves are within the rules of the game and which ones lie outside ethical boundaries. To be truly effective, you will need to develop your own ideas about bargaining ethics. Chapter 11 provides a framework for you to begin thinking about this important topic. You can learn only by doing. At the Wharton Executive Negotiation Workshop, I am fond of quoting a New York lawyer and dealmaker named James C. Freund. Freund has written a number of books on business mergers as well as negotiations. He once stated that, in the last analysis, you cannot learn negotiation from a book. You must actually negotiate. I agree. This book is a guide to better negotiation practice, not a substitute for it. So, take the knowledge you find here and build your own foundations for an effective style. Consider every bargaining opportunity a laboratory to improve your skills. As you gain experience and confidence, you will discover that negotiations will cease being anxiety-filled encounters. Instead, they will become enjoyable and profitable challenges. Part 1. The Six Foundations of Effective Negotiation. Chapter 1. The First Foundation. Your Bargaining Style. You must bake with the flour you have. Danish folk saying. Two men entered a conference room in an office tower high above Lexington Avenue in New York City. It was a cold, wintry day in January. They greeted each other cordially, but with noticeable restraint. Taking seats on opposite sides of a large conference table, they settled down to begin discussions over the possible merger of their two giant companies. On one side of the table sat Peter Yovanovitch, the proud chief executive of an esteemed American publishing house called Harcourt Brace Yovanovitch, or HBJ, which was now teetering on the edge of financial ruin. As the son of one of the firm's founders, Yovanovitch was deeply committed to preserving his family's legacy. Across the table sat Dick Smith, the aggressive, entrepreneurial leader of General Cinema, a large, well-funded conglomerate probing for a corporate foothold in the publishing business. Flanking the two men and waiting expectantly were assorted legal and financial advisors. Both sides had carefully prepared their scripts for the opening of the negotiation. Smith was to be the suitor. After months of analysis, he had concluded that HBJ was a perfect fit for General Cinema, but he was not sure that Yovanovitch shared his vision of the opportunities that lay ahead. Smith planned a detailed presentation on General Cinema's financial strength and reputation. He would indicate that he sympathized with HBJ's woes and was willing to offer hope, but he would be cautious, not wanting to raise expectations about his price. Yovanovitch's team, also very positive about the deal, had prepared Yovanovitch for the role of listener. They had determined that General Cinema offered HBJ its best chance of corporate survival, but they too advised caution. Yovanovitch's attitude would be interested but noncommittal. He would not tip his hand or show his urgency. On cue, Smith began his opening speech, but within seconds, Yovanovitch interrupted, and the HBJ advisor stirred. This was not in the script. What was Peter up to? As Yovanovitch spoke, he took a small box from his coat pocket and placed it on the table between him and Smith. Yovanovitch opened the box to reveal an engraved HBJ watch. He pushed it over to Smith. My father always gave a watch like this to his partners at the beginning of a new business relationship, said Yovanovitch. This is meant to signify my sincere belief that General Cinema is the right buyer for HBJ. It was a risky admission, and both men knew it. The anxiety in the room eased. The two men, joined by their teams, began to talk in earnest about how a deal might be done. They kept talking into the night. Talking to the Mountain. Many years earlier, and thousands of miles away, in a valley in Tanzania, East Africa, two elders representing separate lineages of the Arusha people were meeting in the late morning under a stand of large, shady trees. Beyond the elders in the distance loomed a 14,000-foot mountain, Mount Meru. Two groups of men flanked the elders, standing on opposite sides of the open area under the trees. Shade trees are the conference rooms of rural Africa. Like thousands of similar trees near similar villages, these trees near the Arusha village proved a focal point where people could discuss important business at leisure. Today, the trees sheltered a negotiation. The two elders addressed each other formally, describing a dispute between two neighboring farmers. Each elder described a list of grievances and demanded compensation for various wrongs. Each farmer, echoed by his group, loudly rejected the other's demands and elaborated further on his own elder's arguments. Each man lay claim to a vacant area of land between their farms that had once been occupied by a family whose lineage had died out. The farmer's dispute had led to a series of incidents. One farmer's son had damaged an irrigation gate on the other's land. The owner of the irrigation gate had beaten the farmer's son for trespassing. The farmer of the beaten boy had gone to the elders, demanding a formal meeting to settle the issues. The process they were engaged in reflected their African landscape like a mirror. They were, to use the Arusha word for the opening stage of negotiations, talking to the mountain. And it was going well. A full day of discussion lay ahead. Everyone had brought lunch. The path of negotiation. Two groups, two problems, two cultures. Yet in both situations, people were engaged in a single, familiar process called negotiation, an instantly recognizable human activity that helps people achieve goals and resolve problems. In both cases described previously, as we shall see later, the process ended in a successful agreement. Exactly how and why negotiation achieves such results is the subject of this book. People negotiate in generally similar ways in virtually every culture in the world and have done so since time began. An Arusha elder sitting in the New York conference room where Yovanovitch and Smith met might not have understood the words being said, but he would have recognized the purpose and value of Yovanovitch's gift to Smith. The Arusha negotiation involved a dispute rather than a deal, but as we shall see, it concluded with an exchange of gifts. Gifts are part of a universal language of human relationships, and negotiations are fundamentally about the reciprocity norms underlying such relationships. Negotiations proceed through a form of prudently cooperative communication, and negotiations commonly follow a recognizable four-step path: preparation, information exchange, explicit bargaining, and commitment. In the world of sophisticated big city business deals, lawyers and investment advisors gather in their conference rooms and run through their carefully scripted openings. They discuss the issues, then usually ask for more and offer less than they expect to settle for in the end. In Tanzania, the Arusha people establish their agenda, list their demands, and talk to the mountain, making exaggerated offers and counteroffers. They, too, are staking out the boundaries of possible agreement and watching for signals from the other side about what may or may not be acceptable. From here, people get down to the business of making concessions and establishing commitments. Negotiation is, in short, a kind of universal dance with four stages or steps, and it works best when both parties are experienced dancers. We are all negotiators. All of us negotiate many times a day. We negotiate as children for things we wanted, attention, special treats, and raises to our weekly allowance of spending money. We negotiate as adults for much more complex sets of desires that, when you examine them closely, often come down to the same things we negotiated for as children. Negotiation is a basic, special form of human communication, but we are not always aware that we are doing it. A single definition that can help us recognize negotiation when it happens is the following. A negotiation is an interactive communication process that may take place whenever we want something from someone else or another person wants something from us. We negotiate at kitchen tables as often as we do at bargaining tables. But our personal relationships and professional roles sometimes make complete cooperation and even sacrifice, rather than negotiation, the right answer to many requests. When a winter storm knocks out the electric power in our community and a neighbor calls asking for help, we don't stop to haggle with him. We respond. If our work calls on us to deliver uncompromising customer service and a customer needs something, we accommodate. But notice something. Even these obvious examples of situations that don't seem to involve negotiations arise within the context of ongoing relationships that are characterized by deeply embedded norms of reciprocity. If our neighbor is known for his loud late-night parties and never responds when we ask him to quiet down, his appeal for help in the storm may have to wait until we have taken care of others. And the customers we serve give us more business, the better we serve them. There is a quid pro quo. So situations that involve pure cooperation and sacrifice with no thought of reciprocal accommodation are, in fact, relatively rare occasions. The rest of the time we are involved in some sort of negotiation, broadly defined. Not all negotiations are alike. Bargaining with family members and friends over such things as schedules, meals, obligations, and duties is more in the nature of problem-solving sessions than deal-making. And that's because we usually negotiate differently with those we love than we do with strangers. Pushing past the protective envelope of our closest relationships, we confront a complex world of negotiations with banks, stores, hotels, airlines, credit card companies, healthcare institutions, and other services that govern our day-to-day lives. In the industrialized countries, many of these consumer negotiations are mediated by markets, and we pay prices that are marked or printed on tags. As American consumers are rapidly learning, however, there is often a lot more room to negotiate with hospitals, department stores, and other service providers than we once thought. The norm of customer satisfaction often means there is one price marked on a price tag for those who wish to pay it, and another lower one for those who wish to negotiate. Other parts of the world use an explicit ritual of haggling as the expected way of conducting consumer sales. A visit to the open markets of India or Egypt shows how merchants rely on bargaining to accomplish even the simplest consumer transaction. In these societies, negotiation is an important form of personal expression, and even entertainment, not just a business event. Finally, in our jobs and professions, we depend upon negotiation skills to get things done with coworkers, bosses, suppliers, and at the highest levels, CEOs and boards of directors. Indeed, negotiations within companies and institutions to solve in-house problems are among the most common and troubling negotiation situations many people face on a daily basis. Through all of this, as I pointed out in the introduction, many reasonable people have a nagging, uneasy feeling about negotiation. they are anxious about it. The interpersonal conflicts, the possibility of leaving money on the table, the chance they could be taken, and even the thought that they have done too well are all unsettling. Knowledge about the negotiation process and bargaining strategy helps reduce this anxiety and puts you on the road to improved negotiation results. And the place to begin this knowledge is the same place that all negotiations begin, with the first foundation of effective negotiation, your own style and personality as a negotiator. That is where our study starts. What's your style? Your personal negotiation style is a critical variable in bargaining. If you don't know what your instincts and intuitions will tell you to do under different conditions, you will have a great deal of trouble planning effective strategies and responses. Steve Ross, the super competitive founder of Warner Communications and later CEO of Time Warner Inc., was once playing canasta with his wife and another couple on a trip in a Warner corporate jet. He lost the last game just before the plane was preparing to land and ordered the pilot to circle the airport until he finally won a hand. This was typical of the way Ross played the game of business, and people who negotiated against him were wise to take this personality trait into account. By contrast, Larry King, the popular host of CNN's interview program Larry King Live, has a reputation as one of the nicest men in the world of big-time entertainment. In the middle of King's career, his agent decided to shop Larry to various other television networks. The idea was to gather some competing offers, then demand a multi-million-dollar raise from CNN's owner, Ted Turner. The agent's plan was working fine, with seven-figure offers coming in from various networks, but Turner would not budge. The agent then played his other offer card and said that King might move to a major television network if Turner would not match the competing bids. Turner had known King for years and knew him to be a loyal and cooperative guy, not a hardball negotiator. With the agent sitting right there in Turner's office, Turner picked up the telephone and called King directly. After a little chat about old times and how much he liked King as a person, Turner laid his request on the line. "Stay with me," he said. "Okay," said King, simply. "I'll stay." The agent was flabbergasted. But King was happy. He liked the money he was making. He liked Ted Turner, and he liked the fact that Turner liked him. Ted gave Larry a modest raise. Score one for Ted. Lesson? If you're basically a nice person, it will be a real stretch to act like Steve Ross at the bargaining table. You can do it, but not for long, and not with a lot of credibility. And if you're basically a competitive negotiator, your go-for-it instincts will likely shine through no matter how hard you try to suppress this aspect of your personality. In fact, even if you genuinely hate to negotiate, you can do just fine, provided you accept this about yourself and learn to work with it. I once led a workshop for a number of high-level business luminaries, including a man who founded and serves as chairman of the board at one of the world's most successful internet companies. After the workshop, he confided to me that most negotiations make him uncomfortable. As a result, he avoids the process whenever possible and considers himself a poor negotiator. I responded that he had made several billion dollars, so he could not be that bad. "Not true," he replied. He had succeeded by focusing on his innovation skills, designing an internet auction system that completely eliminates all haggling from the selling process, and by delegating the really tough negotiations at his company to other executives who excel at and enjoy bargaining. Instead of negotiating, he specializes in collaborative aspects of his business, such as strategic planning, managing the board of directors, and enhancing the experience of his company's unique online community. He became successful not by overcoming his negotiation weaknesses, but by accepting them. So, my advice is to begin your study of negotiation by taking a good look in the mirror. Which moves come most naturally and comfortably to you? And how can you use those instincts as a solid foundation to build a set of effective skills and strategies for achieving your goals? You will become the best negotiator you can be by identifying and then building on your genuine strengths and talents. 5 Strategies and Negotiation Styles, a Thought Experiment. To begin our exploration of your bargaining strengths, try the following thought experiment. Imagine you are 1 of 10 people, all of whom are strangers, sitting at a big round table in a conference room. Someone comes into the room and makes the following offer. I will give a prize of $1,000 to each of the first 2 people who can persuade the person sitting opposite to get up, come around the table, and stand behind his or her chair. Do you have that picture in mind? You are 1 of the 10 strangers at the table. You can see the person sitting opposite you, and that person is looking at you. The first 2 people who can persuade the person sitting opposite to get up, come around the table, and stand behind his or her chair gets $1,000. Everyone else gets nothing. What strategy would you use to respond to this strange offer? You will need to move quickly because everyone else is also thinking about what to do. Before you continue listening, pause the recording for a moment. Then close your eyes and think of your response. Note what strategy comes to your mind first and write it down. Then see what other responses you can think of. The possibilities will help me introduce 5 generic negotiating strategies, which will, in turn, lead us to a deeper look at your personality as a negotiation variable. Go ahead, do it now. Welcome back. One reaction is to sit tight and do nothing, suspecting a trick or worrying that you might look like a fool running around a table in response to a stranger's offer. I don't like to negotiate, so I don't do it unless I have to, you might say. This is the avoiding response favored by the internet entrepreneur I mentioned previously. Some people might say that avoiding a negotiation is a cop-out, not a bargaining strategy. But you don't have to look very far to notice that many important negotiations are marked by one side or the other studiously avoiding coming to the table. The North Koreans successfully avoided negotiating over their nuclear weapons programs for years and built up bargaining leverage in the meantime. Presidential candidates in the United States who find themselves ahead in the polls frequently decline to negotiate when their opponents want to increase the number of presidential debates. In general, avoiding is a good strategy when you are happy with the status quo, but it may not be the best approach to the table problem. Perhaps the most obvious response is to offer the person sitting opposite you $500 if he or she will race around and stand behind your chair. This is the compromise solution. Each person agrees to share the gains equally between them. Compromise is a simple, fair, fast strategy that resolves many negotiations amicably. But is it a good strategy for the table problem? You and your partner may arrive at a quick agreement to split the money evenly, but which of you should run and who should sit? During the few seconds it takes to address this issue, other people are already racing around the table. There's no compromise solution to the question of which of you should run, so a simple compromise does not fully solve the problem. An additional strategy is needed. That strategy is our third candidate, accommodation. You could simply get up and run behind your opposite's chair. If you do this in response to your partner's offer to split the money, you can refer to that promise as a bargaining standard in any subsequent negotiation over the money. But there may be no money to split. The people who implemented the 100% accommodating strategy took off as soon as they heard the stranger's offer and got to their partner's chairs before you did. But they face a problem too. The lucky people who were the beneficiaries of the accommodating strategy now have $1,000, and the people who ran have nothing. These helpful negotiators must trust the people for whom they earned the money to share it, without the benefit of a prior commitment on how it will be shared. And remember, everyone at the table is a stranger who never expects to see their counterpart again. The fourth response embodies the competitive strategy. The idea here is to obtain the entire $1,000 as well as the power to decide how it will be shared. One way might be to offer to split the money 50-50 and then later refuse to do so, to renege on your promise. That would obviously be unethical, but some people might do it. After all, there was no mention of a court system to litigate disputes about who said what. An even more aggressive stance would be to lie and say you have a broken leg so you can't move, begging your partner to run as quickly as possible. Are all competitive strategies as ethically dubious as these two? No. We will see examples of many competitive strategies in the pages ahead that are perfectly ethical under any system of morals. But the table problem is not structured well for a strategy that is both ethical and competitive. Moreover, this strategy, like the compromise approach, may take too long to implement. The final strategy is the most imaginative, given the terms of the offer. You get out of your chair, start running, and scream, "Let's both get behind each other's chairs. We can each make $1,000. This can work, if you're quick enough. This is the collaborative or problem-solving strategy. Instead of trying to figure out how to divide $1,000 two ways, the person using this approach has the insight to see that there is a way for both parties to get $1,000 out of the situation. The collaborative strategy is often the hardest to implement. It seeks to discover the underlying problem through good analysis and candid disclosure of interests. Find the most elegant solution by brainstorming many options, and resolve tough issues using fair standards and criteria. In many ways, it represents an ideal. As we'll see, problem-solving strategies are especially useful in complex negotiations, such as those faced by international diplomats or corporate negotiators during mergers or acquisitions. They can also play a useful role in family negotiations, where it's vitally important to avoid having winners and losers. But many obstacles stand in the way of collaborative approaches, such as lack of trust between the parties, greed, personality, cultural differences, and simple lack of imagination. How many of these five strategies did you think of? And, just as important, which of the five would you feel most comfortable and natural implementing? We can now use our knowledge of these five strategies to probe your personal inclinations and styles as a negotiator. In Appendix A, I have provided you with a self-assessment tool we give our participants at the Wharton Executive Negotiation Workshop to help them determine their preferred bargaining styles. It takes only about 5 minutes to complete and score. So right now, we're going to do the bargaining styles assessment. Once we do that and you get your results, we'll come back to this chapter and continue on. Later, we'll go back and look at the various styles and how they interact with one another when we get to Appendix A at the end of this audiobook. The Bargaining Styles Assessment Tool. Follow this four-step process to determine your personal bargaining style preferences. 1. Without giving the matter too much thought and without revising your answers for any reason, please select one statement in each pair of statements that I will be giving you. Select the statement you think is more accurate for you when you face a negotiation or disagreement with someone else, even if you think neither statement is very accurate or both are very accurate. Think about such situations in general, not just ones at work or at home. And don't pick the statement you ought to agree with. Pick the one your gut tells you is more accurate for you most of the time. Some statements repeat, but don't worry about answering consistently. Just keep going. All answers are equally correct. 2. After selecting a statement from every pair, go back and add up the total number of A's, B's, C's, D's, and E's you recorded. Put those totals down on a piece of paper and label them results. 3. Then we'll plot your scores on our evaluation grid, with your strongest inclinations rising to the top while your weakest inclinations will plot near the bottom. And then finally, we'll go back and continue Chapter 1, but later we'll come to this appendix again and look for a more in-depth explanation of your scores and the general subject of bargaining styles. Step 1. Survey style. Of the 30 different examples, each have two options. Listen carefully because Each option has a different letter associated with it. 1. E. I work hard to preserve the relationship with my counterpart. B. I try to identify the underlying issues. Select 1. Number 2. D. I work to diffuse tense situations. Or A. I gain concessions by being persistent. 3. E. I focus on solving the other party's problem. Or D. I try to avoid unnecessary conflicts. 4. C. I search for a fair compromise. Or E. I work hard to preserve the relationship. 5. C. I suggest fair compromises. Or D. I avoid personal confrontations. 6. C. I seek the midpoint between our positions. Or B. I search for the problems underlying our disagreements. 7. D. I tactfully resolve many disagreements. Or C. I expect give and take in negotiations. 8. A. I clearly communicate my goals. Or B. I focus my attention on the other side's needs. 9. D. I prefer to put off confrontations with other people. Or A. I win my points by making strong arguments. 10. C. I am usually willing to compromise. Or A. I enjoy winning concessions. 11. B. I candidly address all the problems between us. Or E. I care more about the relationship than winning the last concession. Number 12. D. I try to avoid unnecessary personal conflicts. Or C. I search for fair compromises. 13. C. I give concessions and expect some concessions in return. Or A. I strive to achieve all my goals in negotiations. 14. A. I enjoy getting concessions more than making them. Or E. I strive to maintain the relationship. 15. E. I accommodate their needs to preserve the relationship. Or D. I leave confrontational situations to others if I can. 16. E. I try to address the other person's needs. Or A. I work hard to achieve my goals. 17. A. I make sure to discuss my goals. Or D. I emphasize areas on which we agree. 18. E. I am always looking out for the relationship. Or C. I give concessions and expect the other side to do the same. 19. B. I identify and discuss all of our differences. Or D. I try to avoid confrontations. 20. A. I obtain my share of concessions. Or E. I strive to maintain relationships. 21. B. I identify and discuss all of our differences. Or C. I look for the compromises that might bridge the gap. 22. E. I develop good relations with the other party. Or B. I develop options that address both of our needs. 23. C. I seek the middle ground. Or A. I strive to achieve my goals in negotiations. 24. B. I identify all of our differences and look for solutions. Or D. I try to avoid unnecessary conflicts. 25. E. I try to preserve the relationship with my counterpart. Or C. I search for fair compromises. 26. D. I emphasize the issues on which we agree. Or B. I uncover and address the things on which we disagree. 27. A. I work hard to achieve my goals. Or B. I pay attention to the other person's needs. 28. C. I look for the fair compromise. B. I try to identify all of the underlying problems. 29. D. I avoid unnecessary disagreements. Or E. I focus on solving the other person's problem. And finally, 30. A. I strive to achieve my goals. Or B. I work to address everyone's needs. And now step 2, record results. Add up all your A, B, C, D, and E answers on the previous page and then write them down. The total, by the way, for all of them should equal 30. Step 3, plot your scores. To begin with, let's identify what the letters stand for. The letter A corresponded to the competing style of negotiating. B, for collaborating. C, for compromising. D, for avoiding. And finally, E, for accommodating. Knowing this, take a look at your scores for A, B, C, D, and E. If for a given letter you had 0 through 3, that's 0 to 30%, you would have a low inclination for that bargaining style. If you had 4, 5, or 6, going from 30% to 70%, you would have a moderate inclination for that bargaining style. And finally, if you had the numbers 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, or 12 next to that number, for that particular category, you would have a 70 to 100% inclination for that bargaining style, meaning it would be your strongest bargaining style. For a deeper insight into bargaining styles, their origins, and their meanings, we'll come back to Appendix A at the end of this book. But for now, let's return to Chapter 1 and pick up where we left off. Your personal bargaining styles are nothing more or less than your inclinations or predispositions to make certain moves when you are negotiating. Those inclinations can come from many sources: childhood, family, early professional experiences, mentors, ethical systems or beliefs, and so on. And your inclinations can change over time as your knowledge of negotiation grows and you gain more confidence in a wider range of skills. But I genuinely believe that most of us have a set of core personality traits that make radical changes in our basic bargaining preferences difficult. For example, I was raised in a household by two loving parents who were very strongly inclined to avoid interpersonal confrontations between themselves and between them and their three children, my two sisters and me. On the bargaining styles assessment, each would have scored very high in the avoiding category. This rubbed off on me more or less permanently. To this day, I instinctively and automatically try to deflect conflict in my interactions with others. Although I have become much more capable of handling conflict through a lifetime of professional and personal experiences, my diplomatic trait is just part of the bargaining personality I bring with me to negotiation interactions. I have other instincts that come into play in different situations and with different people, but my diplomatic trait is never far from the surface. Each style or combination of styles brings a set of associated talents with it. Someone dominated by a strong inclination to compete has a talent for seeing more quickly than others how power and leverage can be gained in a given situation. And he or she derives more satisfaction from getting a great price in a haggling situation than do people who are only weakly inclined to measure their success in these terms. And this person will also see the potential for using a competitive approach in more situations than will the rest of us. Someone who is strongly inclined to accommodate will have a talent for being a team player and helping other people, even when there is a conflict of interest. he or she will be focused on the interpersonal relationship aspect of an interaction, when the rest of us are focused on the money. A person dominated by a preference for compromising will automatically seek simple, fair methods of taking turns or splitting the difference to resolve negotiation differences quickly and fairly, much more often and much sooner in the process than will people who lack this inclination. And finally, people who bring to the table very strong inclinations to collaborate will find themselves facilitating the process, asking lots of questions, and developing different ways of looking at the issues to meet as many needs as possible, including their own. They'll genuinely enjoy complex, prolonged negotiations in a way that someone predominantly inclined towards simple compromises will not. The bargaining styles assessment is a good place to start in understanding your styles. But it's only one data point in your quest to learn about yourself as a negotiator. As you hear about different negotiations in this book and encounter various situations in your life, note which experiences you enjoy and which ones cause you stress. Those that feel good are the ones for which you have natural talents. Build on the insights you gain from these experiences, and in the words of the Danish folk saying that led this chapter, bake with the flour you have. Cooperative versus competitive styles. Beneath the five personal inclinations discussed previously reside two even more basic types, cooperative and competitive. Much research on the personality variable in negotiation has centered around these two basic categories. Depending on the situation, each style can be effective, and each exposes its possessor to certain dangers. In Chapter 12, I give some specific advice on how to compensate for the weaknesses inherent in each approach. Many researchers have wondered whether people are, in general, more competitive or cooperative in their basic orientation toward bargaining. The stereotype negotiator depicted in the press, movies, and mass media is a competitive person who is adept at using hardball tactics such as ultimatums, walkouts, public posturing, and table pounding. This is not surprising, given the mass media's attention to drama and entertainment. But it's not an accurate reflection of how the average professional negotiator, or even the average professional person, actually behaves. Two studies of negotiator behavior have revealed a more complex and accurate profile of how the average professional conducts themselves at the bargaining table. The first study covered American lawyers. The second looked at English labor negotiators and contract managers. A study of American lawyer negotiators, reported by Professor Gerald R. Williams, revealed that roughly 65% of a sample of attorneys from two major U.S. cities exhibited a consistently cooperative style of negotiation, whereas only 24% were truly competitive in their orientation. 11% defied categorization using these two labels. Roughly half of the sample was rated as effective negotiators by their peers. Most interesting, more than 75% of the effective group were cooperative types, and only 12% were competitive. The remaining effective negotiators came from the pool of mixed strategy negotiators. In contrast to the stereotypes, this study suggests that a cooperative orientation is more common than a competitive orientation within at least one sample of professional negotiators in the United States. Moreover, it appears to be easier to gain a reputation for being effective, at least as rated by peers, by using a cooperative approach rather than using a competitive one. The second study was conducted over a period of 9 years by Neil Rackham and John Carlyle in England. Rackham and Carlyle observed the behavior of 49 professional labor and contract negotiators in real transactions. Some of the results of their work will be discussed in chapters 5 and 8 later in this book. The point I want to make here relates to the styles exhibited by these professionals. The most effective of them displayed distinctly cooperative traits. For example, the study examined the use of what the researchers called irritators at the negotiating table. Irritators are such things as self-serving descriptions of one's offer, gratuitous insults, and direct attacks on the other side's proposal, typical competitive tactics. The average negotiator used 10.8 irritants per hour of negotiating time. The more skilled negotiators used an average of only 2.3 irritators per hour. In addition, skilled negotiators avoided what the researchers called defend-attack spirals, cycles of emotion-laden comments assigning blame or disclaiming fault. Only 1.9% of the skilled negotiators' comments at the table fell into this category, whereas the average negotiators triggered or gave momentum to defend-attack spirals was 6.3% of their comments. The profile of the effective negotiator that emerges from this study seems to reflect a distinct set of cooperative, as opposed to, stereotypically, competitive traits. The conclusion from both studies? Contrary to popular belief, perfectly reasonable, cooperative people appear to have a strong potential to become extremely effective negotiators. Gender and culture. Bargaining style preferences originate from deep psychological sources, including conflict resolution patterns with parents, early experiences with siblings and playmates, and lessons we learn at the outset of our careers. And these early formative experiences sometimes derive from two even more basic aspects of our social identities, our gender and culture. These two topics are controversial because intelligent discussion can rapidly slip into destructive and misleading stereotypes. But researchers have identified some reliable truths about these variables, so they are well worth addressing. The gender difference in negotiation. Studies indicate that men and women can differ in the ways they communicate, especially in work settings. Georgetown linguistics professor Deborah Tannen has demonstrated in books such as You Just Don't Understand, Men and Women in Conversation, and Talking from 9 to 5, Women and Men at Work, that men tend to be more assertive, more likely to interrupt their counterpart, and more oriented toward affirming their status. Women, meanwhile, listen more than men do and pay greater attention to emotional rapport and taking turns when speaking. Although you probably know plenty of emotionally oriented men and status-oriented women, the statistics support Tannen's overall findings. The question then becomes how these various behavioral tendencies can be used or adapted so they are sources of strength rather than weakness in particular professional contexts. Research on American women suggests that there are two main ways that gender differences affect negotiations. First, there is solid empirical evidence that women, including professionals in high-stakes business careers, choose to negotiate somewhat less often than do men in such important areas as salary and promotion. In negotiation style terms, women behave on average a bit more cooperatively than men. In a study conducted at Carnegie Mellon University's Business School, Professor Linda Babcock discovered that the difference between the starting salaries women MBA graduates were getting and the salaries men were offered, roughly a $4,000 difference in favor of the men, could be accounted for by one single behavioral factor. 57% of the men asked for more money after receiving an initial offer, whereas only 7% of women asked for more. Those who negotiated, both women and men, received an average of $4,053 more than those who did not. Babcock's research, summarized in her book, Women Don't Ask, confirms this tendency across a number of studies and contexts. Students in my negotiation classes have added another item to the list of practices women tend to follow more than men. They rely heavily on fairness arguments, assuming their counterparts will be responsive to their reasoned, relationship-friendly methods. These tactics can pay off, of course, but only when other parties are tuned to the same relationship wavelength. The experience of one of my students, Marcy, vividly illustrates exactly how the gender factor can subtly work its way into the bargaining process. Prior to starting her MBA studies, Marcy worked for a mid-sized computer services firm and was the only female in her unit. Consistent with Babcock's research, Marcy had not negotiated her offer when she received it from her new employer. In fact, she was simply delighted to get the job. After a couple of years of exemplary work, she gradually became responsible for business representing 30% of the company's revenue. While two better-paid male counterparts who started work with her were handling projects worth only 1% of revenues each, she thought she deserved a raise. Her method of introducing the raise issue was characteristically indirect, however. She went to her boss and requested a performance review. "I thought it was a great way to get my superiors to notice my success without blowing my own horn," she told me during class. "I didn't want to appear pushy." Her tactic did not work. The boss could not find the time to review her. Many women might stop here, but Marcy was persistent. She went to the president of the company and boldly asked for a 20% raise, arguing that her male co-workers were getting 20% more pay by managing fewer people and projects. Thus, a 20% raise was fair. This, too, failed. As she described it, "I kept repeating, 'This is not fair.' In retrospect, fairness required even more than a 20% salary increase based on my contribution, but I was not confident enough to ask. No doubt this insecurity shined forth." In addition, as she puts it, "given that I was working such late hours, seemed so committed to my position, and appeared to have no inclination to look for another job, there was no urgent necessity to listen to me." In the end, Marcy got her raise, just in time for her to turn it down. When the company discovered that she had been accepted into Wharton's...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.